shines a light on three historic elephant tales. Castor and Pollux. The Franco-Prussian War between France and Germany is certainly not held fast inside the public consciousness as a momentous war of note. Yet as with any contrived and utterly unnecessary conflict that we humans deem fit to wage upon one another, there are countless innocent victims with whom suffer horribly. And whilst there is no wish to downplay the human victims in such a tragedy, whilst individually they bear no culpability whatsoever, non-human victims, entirely innocent of the criminal tribulations and trials of their two-legged masters, are also routinely victims of our perpetual need for dominance over all else, let alone our animal friends. Castor and Pollux, named after two notable figures in Greek mythology, were two elephants that lived in the Jardin des Plantes in Paris, Jumbo's original home out of Africa, in 1870 as war broke out between the two nations. Despite the obvious hypocrisy with keeping imprisoned two animals wholly unsuited to the despicably inadequate conditions they were afforded, the city appeared to idolize and hold a deep affection for the two elephants, whom were believed to be siblings, although this was never proven. The effects of the war took many months to reach the central position that Paris occupies within France, though as the Prussian army closed in on the French capital, the decision was made by the Prussian High Council to blockade and starve out the Parisians in the hope of a surrender, with no casualties to the Prussians, due to the fortified nature of the city. No food or other supplies were allowed in or out of the city. By October, the first signs of horse meat had entered the food chain in an attempt to extend the supply of the animals usually bound for slaughter, such as cows and sheep. Donkeys and mules were also not spared the knacker's blade. The equines had blindfolds placed over their eyes and were then hit with a sledgehammer and had their throats slit and were bled out. The blood, being meticulously captured, was invaluable in the production of puddings. Indeed, no part of the animal was allowed to go to waste. Horse meat had gradually found its way into the Parisian diet as a staple of the poor, although it was soon to become a luxury item. By the end of the siege, between 65,000 and 70,000 horses, donkeys and mules had been slaughtered. By mid-November, and with the blockade still in place, Parisians became more desperate. Rationing, something which only affected the poor, as the wealthy elite feasted right up until the end of the blockade, were allowed only 100 grams of meat a day, which was now coming from even more unscrupulous sources. Vendors openly selling cats, rats and dogs. They were gutted and dressed and hung up on display, charging a premium at the time for the questionable fare. The restaurants, having little else to serve, were all closed by December. As the food supply grew ever thin by the day, talk turned to the fate of the animals at the Jardin des Plantes and other locales. Monkeys were deemed too close to humans, and so were spared the blade, as was the hippopotamus, although apparently only for economical reasons, as the price tag placed upon his head was unwilling to be met by any local butcher or wholesaler. The carnivorous cats, too, were strangely spared, the reason claimed that no one wanted to catch them. Of course, one wonders what the lions and the tigers were being fed during this time. One could only surmise they were not being fed at all, and were left to famine during the blockade. Wolves, a more slight and less fearsome carnivore, more akin to a dog, apparently were not spared the blade, unlike their bigger cat cousins. The herbivorous animals, such as deer, antelopes, camels, yaks, kangaroos, and zebras, were put on the menu for those able to pay the hefty fee for which their flesh garnered. On the 18th of December, elephant was being served in Paris. Though there is some debate as to the identity of these elephants who did not make it to Christmas, there is little doubt that these elephants were not Castor and Pollux, but rather another unnamed, unheralded elephant from a zoo other than the Jardin des Plantes. No less a tragedy, but sadly their lack of pomp and circumstance and historical namesakes means their passing has been met with little fanfare since and have been all but forgotten. Despite the city's love for Castor and Pollux, they appeared to love their waistlines more, and Castor was killed by firing of an exploding steel-tipped bullet at a distance of 10 metres. It is unknown how many bullets were fired and the length of time it took for Castor to pass away. Whether Pollux was privy to the death of his companion remains unclear, although he too was disposed of the following day. Their bodies fetching 27,000 French francs from the Boucherie Anglaise, the English butchery, with the trunk meat selling for near four times the price of the rest of their flesh, netting the butchers a tidy profit. Whilst there are claims that for many people of Paris, they did not know that elephant meat had been put on the menu, there were laws enforced at the time as to the strict labelling of the origin of the flesh being offered, with strict penalties applying for merchants who broke the law. Historical records of menus during the time show a litany of zoological animals listed alongside common French culinary techniques. A month after the demise of Castor and Pollux, and after 3 days of shelling from Otto von Bismarck, after growing weary of the tactics of the Prussian High Council, the blockade ended, and the dietary habits of Parisians slowly returned to normal. Of course, had they waited but a month longer, then Pollux and Castor may have been spared such an ignominious end, though the alternative option of decades of slavery is surely no less cruel. And what of the other countless animals, either domestic or wild, whom suffered the same fate as these two imprisoned pachyderms? The simple fact that no tale of note bears their remembrance is no greater crime than the murder of two elephants to satiate the hungers of the wealthy in times of war. It is little wonder, then, when animals are treated as objects and placed inside zoos and other facilities for the spectacle and profit of people, that few would shy from the thought of butchering these innocent creatures when the opportunity arose. Black Diamond. Black Diamond, an Indian elephant of considerable size and note, was born in 1898 at the turn of the century and weighed in at a whopping 9 tons. Al Barnes of the Al G. Barnes Circus listed him as the largest Indian elephant in captivity at the time, a boastful claim common from carnival barkers and proprietors throughout the land, though in Black Diamond's case may well have been true. Black Diamond was notoriously bad-tempered, difficult to work with, and required significantly more precaution given to him during his sojourns in public, of which he took part in the Texas town of Corsicana on October 12, 1929. Black Diamond had already had his name changed from Tusco and Congo after having killed 3 men. The name change allowing the owner of the circus to continue utilizing the noteworthy elephant in his shows without arising too much suspicion from the authorities or general public. It was common for circuses to parade down the main street of towns and cities in those days, heralding their arrival and giving the public a taste of what they could look forward to should they part with a little of their hard-earned at the circus later that day. Black Diamond had already had his tusks sawn down and was wearing a metal bar between the stumps over his trunk to limit its range of movement. He was also wearing extra chains and was shackled to a female elephant walking either side of him, literally an elephant purpork if ever there was one. A man by the name of J.D. Prickett was escorting Black Diamond through the streets that day. Prickett had formerly been a trainer of Black Diamond's, although had left the circus some time earlier, and was working for wealthy landowner and socialite Eva Speed Donahue. Donahue was also in attendance that day at the parade. As Prickett brought Black Diamond to a halt near Donahue, it is claimed, although unverified, that she had asked to pat the massive beast. What caused Black Diamond's outburst is unknown, although he picked up Prickett in his trunk and flung him over a car, breaking his wrist. He then pulled forward to get Donahue, who was apparently standing between 2 parked cars, stomping on her and dragging her out into the streets, damaging the cars in the process. Bystanders attempted to rescue Donahue from Black Diamond, although were unable to until circus staff tightened the chains around him, where she was collected and taken to a nearby hospital, although was pronounced dead on arrival. Immediately, calls for the elephant's death rang up from the angry mob that had remained on the streets amidst all the commotion. There were even calls for the elephant to be lynched, a popular method of death at the time for African Americans. The angry mob followed Black Diamond back home to his travel car, where he was guarded by 2 circus staff. A self-appointed assassin attempted to gain entry to the elephant's car armed with a pistol, although was prevented from doing so by circus staff. It has been claimed that Black Diamond, aware of Donahue for taking his trainer away from her, acted out of jealousy, killing Donahue on sight. Of course, if he was so fond of Prickett, he would have been unlikely to have thrown him through the air to get to her. Ringling owned the Barnes Circus, and the owner at the time wrote to Barnes stating that he wished for Black Diamond to be killed in some humane way. In what will not be the last time a number of locals offer up their creative and cruel suggestions as to the best way to dispose of an elephant, cries from everything from poisoning and strangling to Corpus Christi and other Texas towns offer to drown him by tying lead weights to his feet and dragging him into the water with tugboats. To the notable dismay of some disturbed and troubled individuals, a firing squad was chosen as his method of execution. On October 16th, in what too would become a familiar yet ghastly pastime, spectators lined the route of Black Diamond's final march to a pasture a couple of miles outside Kennedy, near San Antonio. Black Diamond was then chained to a block to prevent his escape, at which point a volley of somewhere between 50 to 170 bullets were fired until he collapsed and died. The crowd of bloodthirsty spectators rushed forward to claim souvenirs from the fallen elephant. A Houston taxidermist arranged for the head to be transferred to the Houston Museum of Natural Science. A local undertaker and member of the firing squad made a footstool out of one of Black Diamond's feet, which is still proudly displayed at the Carnes County Museum. Local butchers stripped the hide and sold pieces of his flesh for a dime. Less than 2 weeks later, the engineered financial crash known as the Great Depression struck and the stock market collapsed. Ringling was heavily in debt at this time, and the Algie Barnes circus ended soon thereafter. Old Bet. There is still considerable controversy surrounding whether Old Bet was in fact the first or the second elephant to arrive on American shores. Whilst a case can be made either way, the elephant's true notoriety comes not from her perceived arrival date, but for what she was used to create, the modern circus. Old Bet was purchased by Hackaliah Bailey of Summers in New York in the early 1800s. The sum paid has also been disputed, with the amount generally regarded as being between $1,000 and $1,500. Bailey, seemingly a shrewd farmer and businessman, originally purchased the animal as a draft beast of burden to plough his fields, theoretically faster and more efficiently than a horse ever could. Bailey, seemingly having his mind changed as to his career path, when his neighbours and other locals offered to pay him to stare at the creature, which must surely have been quite a sight some 200 years ago. So Bailey set off with his elephant, walking from town to town under the cover of darkness, to prevent anyone from getting a free look at the animal. The business model soon took hold, and it wasn't too long before other basement philanthropists and starry-eyed entrepreneurs were tracing their way across the country with a veritable menagerie of animals in tow, offering to avail their animals to an eager public, for a fee of course. If the name Bailey rings a bell at this time, you would be correct in assuming that Bailey belongs to the infamous Barnum and Bailey Circus, which only recently ended after nearly a century and a half of performances. P.T. Barnum had worked for Bailey as a young boy, and credited the man with inventing the circus. Though as sad a tale as the birth of the modern circus and the millions of animals it has helped to exploit would be, Old Bet was killed by disgruntled farmer Daniel Davis on the 14th of July, 1916, a crime for which he would be charged and convicted for. Davis believed that it was sinful for Bailey and his ilk to fleece hard-working farmers of their money to stare at an elephant. Some people dispute the claim to Davis's righteousness and humanitarian motivations around the murder of Old Bet, with others claiming jealousy as his prime motivation. A memorial to Old Bet was erected by Bailey at the Elephant Hotel in Summers, New York in 1825, where it remains to this day as one of the nation's oldest monuments. Nearly a century later, an elephant named John L. Sullivan was taken on a 53-mile trek with his handler from Madison Square Garden to the Elephant Hotel in Summers, New York, to lay a wreath of flowers in remembrance to Old Bet. Of course, stories such as this create a sense of wonder, emotion, and awe in those who hear it. Like the elephant, of his own volition, up and walked 4 days to pay his respects to a long-departed elephant. While such empathy and respect is routinely witnessed in the elephants in the wild, well aware of where the bones of their loved ones are located, to which they routinely return, this was nothing more than animal abuse marked as human showmanship, however well-intentioned it may have been. So I written and so I say, Bingamoon is on his way.